Everybody's probably familiar with Jim. He's given a talk here before, and it's always been very good. A little quick background. Excuse me. Jim was born in Chicago and graduated from the University of Illinois with a degree in industrial engineering in 1971. He earned a Naval Aviator Wings with the Marine Corps in 1972 and a Master's in Management in 1976. In 1978, he became a pilot with Continental Airlines. He retired in 2013 with over 28,000 flight hours. In 1997, he helped found the OB-10 Bronco Association as a nonprofit corporation to establish an aviation museum in Fort Worth. Today, the Bronco Association operates the Fort Worth Aviation Museum that tells the story of how aviation has changed lives, the economy, and culture of North Texas. Since 1911, it maintains a growing collection of 26 warbirds. Jim is executive director and chairman of the Bronco Association. He is a member of the Tarrant County Historical Commission and one of the original founders of the Texas Centennial Commemoration Group. He lives in Grapevine, Texas with his wife, Donna, which is here, and he is married, has one son and a grandson. At the beginning of World War I, Texas had not progressed much beyond the Civil War. With the beginning of the hostilities in Europe, Texas underwent a transformation that changed everything forever, and many of those changes are still being felt today. His presentation discusses Texas in World War I from a home perspective and shows how it still affects the culture and economy have changed forever. And he's going to begin with the border conflicts from 1910 to 1917 and then continue through the war years after the war and the lasting effects still evident today. With that, please welcome Jim.
Okay, now I'm on. Yeah, I think I'm on now. Yeah. No, I'll use this one. See, I think Don said I just need to do that. There we go. Okay. Well, good evening. Thanks for being here tonight. Buster pretty much already told you everything, so are there any questions? Okay, as Bob mentioned, it's going to be a little bit different tonight. We're going to talk about the First World War and how Texas was changed and the world was changed because of the war. We are going to talk about some aviation stuff, but we're going to talk about a lot of other things here tonight, too. One of the reasons that they've given me the privilege of speaking here tonight is because of what will take place next month. Anybody, does April 6th have a meaning to anybody here other than if it's your birthday? Okay, it's the 100th anniversary of the U.S. entry into the First World War. And so next month, all over the country, and especially here in North Texas, you will start to see a lot more commemorations for the next couple years. We will have one on April 8th. At the Veterans Memorial Park on Camp Bowie at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. So we'll talk a little bit about that later. But what we're gonna do tonight is we're gonna talk about Texas from 1900 to 1920 and then today, the effect of the war on people, places, and things. So just as a little bit of a refresher, because I know you all are very, very familiar with this information, over 4 million Americans served in the First World War. 116,000 plus died. The Great War changed everything. It began the American century, it set America on a path to superpower status, and it set the stage for the next century of war and warfare. Interesting to note that 116,000 plus deaths, and that's an old figure, frankly. We think now that it's actually quite a bit higher than that. Considering the period of time that the US was involved in the war, that was one of the highest casualty rates that the United States has ever been involved with in wars. So almost 100,000 Texans, yeah, 1 million Texans registered for the draft, 198,000 Texans served. 5,171 Texans died in service. That number could potentially be almost twice as much as that. A third of the casualties occurred in the U.S., many of them from the Spanish flu in 1918, which affected here. 36,000 African Americans served here in Texas, and that's 18% of the total. 50,000 Mexican Americans served, approximately. And we say approximately because Mexican Americans or American Mexicans or Tejanos, there's about three or four different terms that that they referred to themselves as, were considered white. So there is no specific figure on Mexican Americans. 6,000 Native Americans from Oklahoma and Texas served. And that number, 6,000, is the highest percentage of any ethnic group that served within the military here in Texas. This is just a little information that we'll have a test on later. And this is just to give you an idea of where these three cities, and actually four cities starting in 1910, ranked within the United States in terms of population. San Antonio was the largest in Texas, followed by Houston and then Dallas. And Houston and Dallas were relatively the same. By 1910, Fort Worth had joined the top 100, and you can see those numbers there. Houston almost doubled, 1.6 times, but that's the growth rates. So this is Texas pre-1910. It had not changed very much from post-Civil War. About the only thing that had really changed here was the introduction and expansion of the railroads. Now, if you look on these along the border here, you will see the original forts that were along the border in 1910. Bliss, Fort Clark, San Antonio, Fort McIntosh, Fort Ringgold, and Fort Brown. Clark was the oldest. That predated the Civil War. But this is where we were in 1910, pre-1910. The population of Texas, we were fifth in the nation with not quite 4 million people. This is pretty much what Texas looked like. This is one of my favorite pictures, by the way. We've got an ox cart here, and we've got a car in the background, and it's a dirt road. And there was only 150 miles of paved highway in the entire United States at this point in time. Not just Texas, but the entire United States. So what the other thing that we had was there were, in Texas alone, there were 725 manufacturers of vehicles producing vehicles on 125 different wheelbases. Okay, that's going to become important. Oil had just recently been discovered, and so the economy had not really started to change over to oil and gas yet, because in 1910, there were only about 40 cars between Dallas and Fort Worth both. And if you wanted to drive from Dallas to Fort Worth, it would take you nearly 9 hours. I understand it can do that now too, but still. Of course, cotton was king. We're still growing a lot of cotton, although the agricultural situation in Texas down in the South Valley was starting to change a little bit, and they were doing more food and a little bit less cotton. And then, of course, we were still ranchers, still a lot of cattle ranching going on. But prejudice prevailed. Okay, even in that point in time, the Civil War was over, we're not supposed to be as segregated as we were, but prejudice prevailed across the country and across the state. So this is what we looked like in 1861. Remember, I said that our economy was a little bit removed from the Civil War. It was essentially coal and steam. And so what we did have is we had some railroads. By 1881 or so, the railroads had already taken over the trail system, so most of the trails were not being utilized any longer. But by 1909, this is the rail system in the state of Texas. That was the biggest change from the Civil War, was the railroads. And by 1911, Texas became the state with the most railroad mileage in the entire United States, and it still holds that distinction today. So that kind of sets the stage for World War I. So now we come into this point, how many forts and airfields were built during that time period. And this is where the true economic impact of the First World War started to take place. We started out with six camps or forts. We all know the difference between camps and forts. Camps are temporary, forts are permanent. Okay, so Camp Bowie was built as a temporary establishment. So all of the green ones here are the new camps. and all of the blue ones are airfields. So we went from 6 to 24 camps in the state, and we went from 0 to 15 airfields. Now, what you're going to find as we go through this, that during the First World War, there was lots of different technologies that came to the front, machine guns, gas, medicine, tanks, aviation. Aviation was one of the biggest developments during the war, and we will talk about that. So what you see, though, is all of those had to be built from something, didn't they? Most of them were wood. Virtually all of the wood for all of these camps and airfields came right out of this area, East Texas. And it was the African Americans of that area that cut down the timber and produced the lumber for the building of all of these forts and camps. So this was considered to be the progressive era from 1900 to 1920. It was an era not only here in the United States, but across the world, that there were massive changes taking place. There was changes taking place with big business. The government was trying to limit monopolies. Over in Europe, the war was involved because of the monarchies and replacing monarchies with other representative forms of government. So there were massive changes taking place in agriculture, lumber, oil, the railroads, politics especially, segregation, growth, urbanization. You saw that from the chart. People started leaving the country and starting to go to the cities. And suffrage and prohibition, many other things too. And keep in mind that this 24 camps and 15 airfields, Texas, out of all of the other states in the Union, had almost half of all the military operation of the United States took place in Texas. But the border conflicts continued. Now, we talk about when did we actually enter the war? And I am convinced that we entered the war at least in 1914 for a couple of different reasons, potentially even long before that, maybe as early as 1907. But Jim, the war didn't start in Europe until 1914. That's true. But the German government was doing a lot of things even long before the war started to try to attempt to destabilize us and encourage Mexico and Japan to side with them against any future conflicts. So the border conflicts continued, and then in 1910, what happened? We had the Mexican Revolution, right? And so there was a lot of destabilization along the border. There was a thing called the Plan of San Diego, which was for Mexicans inside the United States to start to revolt and destabilize the country. So, and then in 1914, we had a little incident down in Veracruz. You familiar with that one at all? The Germans were trying to bring arms into Mexico, and Woodrow Wilson decided to stop them. The Mexican government didn't appreciate that we did that. There were some people that died down there, and Wilson wanted an apology from the Mexicans, and they wouldn't give it to him. So that was kind of the first case with Woodrow Wilson being involved with some type of war things and keeping us out of war that actually started armed conflict. But what really took place, and I'm not convinced yet that the Zimmerman telegram is the actual thing that put us into the war, although it was right after that Congress declared war. But the Zimmerman telegram was kind of the last straw that broke the camel's back. The Arthur Zimmerman, who was the foreign secretary for Germany, had been sending messages to the Mexican government suggesting to them that they would continue to supply people, officers for their army, they would continue to supply munitions for them, and what they wanted the Mexican government to do was attack the United States from the south. We had already, by this point in time, done the punitive expedition, the Mexican Border Service. Wilson had nationalized the National Guard and had sent them to the border for border service in Texas, Arizona, New Mexico. Most of the state's militias or most of the state's National Guards that were federalized came to Texas and served in Texas somewhere along the border, or they ended up training in San Antonio or in Houston. So a lot of activity was here. Yes, Ted. Oh yeah, there were lots of them. There were German officers within the Mexican army. They had all kinds of other influence. In fact, they were actually trying to get the Japanese to establish naval bases in the Bay of California, because we had we had an immigration policy at that point in time that did not allow Asians into the country. And the Japanese took offense at that. The Chinese and the Japanese took offense at that because of all of them that had come over here earlier and helped with the railroads and things. So at any rate, the border conflicts continued, and a telegram that was intercepted by the British initially and then was turned over to us indicated that Arthur Zimmerman had suggested, not had suggested, he had said specifically, if you help us against the Americans after the war is over and we win, you can have Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona back. Interesting stuff. And then when he was confronted with that, he could have easily said, no, I didn't say that. And he said, yeah, sure, I said that. And the whole issue about the telegram goes on and on. We're not going to get into that too much tonight. Okay, but during the war, as I mentioned, almost 200,000 Texans served, 36,000 African Americans right here. A lot of them, by the way, went up to New York and joined the and joined a unit up in New York, the Harlem Hellfighters. But many of them joined here. Of course, we had the Mexican Americans, and you'll not see any pictures. I've looked all over for pictures of groups of Mexican Americans in uniform, and you just don't find them, because as an ethnic group, they were considered white, so you very seldom see them. There was plenty of prejudice against them when they were in the war, and I'll mention a couple of those things. But then again, the Native Americans, 6,000 of them. Anybody ever heard of World War II, the Code Talkers? Who's heard of the World War I Code Talkers? Okay, very few. The point is that most of the things that took place in the Second World War, when we talk about Liberty, Liberty Gardens or Victory Gardens, and we talk about war bonds, and we talk about Rosie the Riveter and a lot of these other things, it's really World War II was more like World War 1.2, and that these things all started in the First World War. Rosie the Riveter had a mother. She worked in the factories during the First World War. So at any rate, all of these people were fighting for their country. Makes sense, right? What country were the Native Americans fighting for? They were fighting for their country. Not necessarily the United States, but their country. There was also a thing that came out of all of this because there were so many different ethnic groups, we'd never mobilized on this scale before. And German Americans as a group were one of the largest ethnic groups within the entire United States. There were also Irish and Slavs and Czechs and Poles and people from all over the world. And one of the problems that they encountered, and it started here in Texas, was training the troops. So they came up with what was referred to as the Camp Gordon plan. And the Camp Gordon was in Atlanta. And the plan there was they were losing time and it was taking forever to train anybody because you were trying to train somebody whose native language was not English. So the Camp Gordon plan was to have native speakers start to do the basic training with the groups. So you had Native Americans, you had Mexican Americans, Polish Americans, German Americans, Russian Americans were all being trained in their native language for their basic training, and then they were sent back together to be integrated with the other forces, except for the African Americans. They were never integrated. So they were fighting for acceptance, but they never got it. So here's one of the other aspects of the war. This is a women in war. Mentioned it a little bit. We had women working in all types of factories. They came out of the homes to work in office jobs, to work in factory jobs. They came out of the farmhouse to work on the farms and ranches. They worked all over, just like the Second World War. They did volunteer work with the Red Cross. They helped free up people so that they could be trained. The Women's Land Army Service, the National League of Women's Service. And this is the one of the ones that I liked. We have social media of today. These posters were the social media of the day for World War I. You know, wireless radio was relatively new, but posters were the social media of the day. So this one, you've got the YMCA, the YWCA, Salvation Army, Knights of Columbus, the War Camp Community Service, the American Library Association, and the Jewish Welfare Board. Thank you, Hollis. And then this one is from the U.S. Food Administration, encouraging people to grow food. So some of the social turmoil. There was social turmoil at all kinds of levels. This was not necessarily a popular war. In fact, it wasn't a popular war at all. There was a lot of people on both sides of the scale here that thought we should go to war, didn't think we should go to war. The Irish Americans thought that we should side with the Germans because they didn't like the Brits. And then there were other people that thought we should do that too. So there was also a large group of German Americans, as I mentioned. In fact, many of them were reservists in the German army. And so there was a fear that these people would be mobilized. And in fact, the German government was encouraging them to go to Mexico, where they could be rearmed and turn around and come back and fight against the United States. In fact, at the same point in time, the Germans were suggesting in newspapers to the African Americans that they should go to Mexico, enlist in the army, and come back and fight the United States. So, social turmoil. I'm going to just let you read some of these because they're really something to look at. Kaiser Wilson. It was illegal in many places to speak German. You couldn't gather in German groups. In fact, one of the reasons for prohibition in Texas was to ruin the German brewers in Central Texas. Because if you ruined their businesses, they would come apart. Of course, the whites and Hispanics, they still didn't want those people around. I love this one. Women, bring all the voters into the world, let women vote. And then prohibition. Prohibition was coming into force for a lot of different reasons. One of them was for morale. Another one was to kind of break down the German brewers. So on all kinds of different levels, there was social turmoil. Now, along with this came the Bankhead Highway, and we should all be at least a little familiar with that because there's been so much talk about it here the last couple of years. The Bankhead Highway was part of a 1960 Railroad Act to build a road across the country so that the military could go from Washington, D.C. to San Diego. A few years prior, the Lincoln Highway had been built so that you could go from New York through Chicago to San Francisco. So this was kind of revolutionary at the time because, just settled a few minutes ago, there were 725 different manufacturers of vehicles and 125 different wheelbases. Building a road means there's going to have to be standardization. Well, that was sort of what the Bankhead Highway looked like early on. It came to look like this, two-lane highway, but there's a specific distance there. And this is where we established the wheelbase that we all live with today and the size of the roads that we all live with today. And how do you think that wheelbase was established? Railroads. Not the railroads, close. It was established by the British. Because their vehicles had a 56-inch wheelbase, ours vehicles had to be compatible with what they did, how they transported vehicles, the roads they worked on, and in France also. So we have a 56-inch wheelbase today because of the First World War. The width of our roads started out because of the First World War. So you travel on these things every day and in vehicles every day, and it's because of what took place during the First World War. But this is the way the Bankhead Highway actually started. One of those vehicles with a 56-inch wheelbase busting through the area and carving out roads. If you look at the map, you'll see there's a little blip in the middle of Texas. It's because the Bankhead Highway for a while went all kinds of different directions here in North Texas. Okay, some of the other things that took place here. This is the Houston Ship Channel in about 1904. You could pretty much throw a stone across there. This is Orange, Texas. These are shipbuilding. You'll notice there's a five-masted sailing ship back here. Orange, Texas was the biggest shipbuilding area in Texas for a period of time. They built the last 16 sailing ships. Those sailing ships were built specifically to carry lumber from the United States to Europe to help the war effort. They also started to build steamships, wooden steamships at first and then metal ships later on. During a period of time from about 1917 to 1919, more ships were built along the Texas coast, Gulf Coast, than any other state in the Union. And that was all along Orange. course, out of Galveston, we were shipping lots and lots of cotton to the to Europe. And oil. We were shipping oil to Europe also. So shipbuilding and shipping became a big industry here in Texas. So now you can all relax. We're going to talk about airplanes a little bit. But this is the emergence of aviation. That is the entire United States Air Force in 1911. One Wright B flyer. This is Benjamin Floy right there. He had this airplane and took it, and they trained it down to San Antonio, and he had all of about 2 hours of instruction from the Wright brothers. And so he got instructions via the mail. He'd go out and crash it. They gave him a very small budget. He'd crash the airplane, break it, and keep going. At the start of the war, there were only there were somewhere between 20 and 50 airplanes in the entire United States. Somewhere in there. That number seems to vary. In the entire world, there were only 750 airplanes in the entire world at the beginning of the war in 1914. By the end of the war, there were over 250,000 airplanes. So you're talking about 5 years, that kind of growth in airplanes. Well, so this is a JN3 Jenny, and this is down on the border service. This was the part of the initial Air Force that came through Fort Worth here in 1915. You know, the entire Air Force came through here from Texas City to going down to San Antonio. All six airplanes and all six pilots came through here, stopped here in Ryan's Pasture, and Fort Worth was established as a stopping point. And it was one of these airplanes that came through here. They used primarily Jennies, but they also used a few other airplanes down on the border service. They found out that airplanes were highly susceptible to arid conditions and all of the sand and everything else. So in many respects, aviation was a failure on the border. They did find that it was reasonable for liaison and getting people around quickly if they needed to. But in terms of finding Pancho Villa, they never did do that. So this is a typical of World War I with the structures in the back. And this is from Love Field, by the way. This is the flying officers. We have this picture up in the museum, and I've got two people here that I really like, because you know these big panoramics were really kind of sewn together. So we've got the thin man here, and we've got the fat man right there. It's just, I just always get a kick out of that. So there were other things that were taking place besides the military mobilization here, and one of those was what was taking place with stock movement here, livestock movement here in Fort Worth. So we take a look, and these are just the numbers. And just to give you some basic idea, in 1903, there were over 732,000 animals that passed through Fort Worth through the stockyards. By 1909, it was just over 2 million. And of course, this is the Swift plant that were probably recognized somewhat. But by 1917, we started supplying Europe in 1914, mostly horses and mules. But by 1917, our stockyards here was the largest stock exchange of livestock in the world. And that's one other factor of the changes that took place here and the impact of the economy on the economy and culture. So this gentleman right here, Benny Keith, we all know who he is, right? I've done this for a couple of other lectures, and I talk about Benny Keith, and they all go, "Who is he?" I did one with a group of high school kids not too long ago, and they said, "Benny Keith." And I said, "You see his trucks every day." And they said, "We do." And I said, "Yeah. When you go out, you go home, look, you're going to see a big white truck, and it's going to say Ben E. Keith on the side." And so this gentleman probably had more to do with establishing Fort Worth as a military town and an aviation town than anybody else. I know we talk about Amon Carter a lot, but Benny Keith is really the driving force behind all of this. In 1913, Carter established the Chamber of Commerce. By 1915, Benny Keith was the president of the Chamber of Commerce. You know, he started out selling fruit and vegetables to the hotels and restaurants around town. By the time it was 1915 or so, he was already the president of the Chamber of Commerce. And so what he did is he was down in San Antonio when he heard about the Congress declaring war. He immediately rushed back to Fort Worth because he knew that Fort Worth, there had been talk about building up for the war, and he knew Fort Worth would be an ideal place to build a fort. and that it might also be a good place to build airfields. So he immediately came back and gathered together a bunch of the citizens, probably most of the Chamber of Commerce, and they established a community group to go ahead and encourage the military to come here. So he went to Washington, talked to the people in the Pentagon, said Fort Worth is a great place for one of these camps that you're going to start, and we'd like you to send an inspection team down. So they did this, and this is about May of 1917 now, April, May 1917. So the inspection team comes down here, and the city had gotten together, and what they decided to do is they were going to give Arlington Heights to the military. Arlington Heights had originally been started in about the 1880s as a subdivision, and it never really took off. There was very little building that was going on out there. We've all seen these pictures of new communities out in the West where they had the streets all in place and everything, but there was nobody there. And in Florida, that was kind of like what Arlington Heights was like here. So the sewers were in, the water was in, telephones were being put in, all of those kinds of things. So they decided that they would offer that to the military, not charge them for it. They would give it to them for a camp. So they go to Washington and they make their pledge. So the inspection team comes down. So the citizens committee is waiting there at the railroad station when all of these general officers get off the train to go do the inspection of Arlington Heights. And it's just in a downpour. The rain is just coming down. Everything is flooding. And everybody was just kind of really moping around. They said, this is terrible. We're not going to get a camp now. So they get in the vehicles. They go out to Arlington Heights. And the generals are delighted. And so Benny Keith was asking them, and he said, well, we thought for sure you were going to turn this down. And they said, no, that area drains so well. Of course, if you've been listening to the news, it doesn't drain well at all anymore. But it did then. And so the Army said, we will take this on. About the same time, remember in 1915, we said that the first Aero Service airplanes came through town here. Benny Keith met Benjamin Folloy when he came through and was a guest of Amon Carter. So he knew Benjamin Folloy. So he knew that they were also going to need to have airfields, so he went back up to Washington. He was learning over this period of time something from Carter, that he was making as many deals over dinner and drinks as he was over a desk. That was one of his quotes. And so he started doing more of that. He'd go up to Washington. He met with Benjamin Folloy at a dinner for a very short period of time. Benjamin had to leave, and he went up and talked to him and told him about how Fort Worth would be a good place for one of the airfields. At that point in time, Benjamin Folloy had been working with and talking with the Canadians about establishing a field down here. He had to leave. He took out a cigarette paper and wrote on it, do what you can for this Texan, and handed it to General Horace. General Horace came down to inspect the area, and we were hoping for one field because Waco wanted a field, Dallas wanted a field, Mineral Wells wanted a field. Everybody wanted one of these Canadian fields. And the British general said, nope, we're going to build them all right here in Fort Worth. So that's how, because of this gentleman, we got three Royal Flying Corps fields here in Fort Worth, along with Camp Bowie. Now, construction on these things began in about July of 1917, at least Camp Bowie did. The airfields didn't start until a little bit later. So the fields, so everything starts to get built in June and July of 1917. By August, the troops are starting to show up. Well, the city was about 70,000 when this started. By the time the airfields were built in the fall and the Royal Flying Corps came down here with all of their people, the size of the city had swelled to almost 130,000 people. Now think about what would happen here today in Fort Worth if within 6 months we went from 800,000 people to 1.4 million. We think the roads are clogged and we think there's a lot of construction and delays and things now. You read through the papers and they will talk to you about how they had to stand in line for everything. Stand in line for breakfast, for lunch, for dinner, to do anything, they had to stand in line. So that was part of it, was the huge influx. But here's some of the economic factors. Day laborers were getting $2.50 a day. That's about $47 a day right now. Carpenters were getting $8 a day. That's $150 a day. So skilled labor was in short supply. Camp Bowie cost $3 million in 1917. That's equivalent to $65 million today. The total of the camps in the fields was $11 million. So each of the airfields was about $2.5 million. That's a total today of $206 million just for the infrastructure for the military. That doesn't include what it costs to feed all of the horses and feed the people and take care of 40,000 troops that were here, in addition to 20,000 or so animals or more. Because the military had not yet become mobilized with the internal combustion engine vehicles. It was mostly horses. So I just had to show you this one because I really think it's cool. That's Benny Keith when he first started out in about 1906. You know, so we've got a picture of him on a cart like that, and we've got a picture somewhere of Eamon Carter sitting on top of an alligator about the same time period. So it's fun to look at these people when they were younger. So North Texas in World War I, established Camp Bowie, the Royal Flying Corps and the Army airfields, and the helium production for the Army and the Navy. That was all an outpouring of World War I. Of course, the helium didn't really come in until after the war, but this was a point in time when the government wanted to start developing that. And of course, the ubiquitous Jennies. Interesting airplanes, the JN-4s. You know, here in Texas, the Canadians brought down what they referred to as the Canucks, which meant that they had ailerons on the upper and lower flight surfaces, and they were attached with a strut. So they were a little bit more maneuverable. They had a bigger tail. This is not a Canuck, but it had a bigger tail. You'll see that in some other pictures. Jenny, very interesting airplane. Now, of course, it was one of the first of the really mass-produced airplanes. These particular ones were built in Canada, the ones that came down from up there. But the airplane had a lot of firsts. I was reading about one this afternoon that I found interesting. The Marine Corps flew Jennies for a while, too, in 1919 and 1920. And they started the idea of dive bombing. And one of the Marine pilots decided that he was going to come up with some kind of a sight. So he took a machine gun barrel and mounted it in front of him on the cowling so he could look through the machine gun barrel, sort of like a telescope, to be able to look at the target. The bomb dropping took place. They put a bomb in a burlap sack and hung it under the airplane and just dropped it when he said drop it. But that was for the first of the dive bombing. Jenny had a lot of firsts because of the nature of the airplane. This was unprecedented mobilization, and it wasn't just here. It was taking place all across the country. It got so heavy in terms of supplying the East Coast, because that's where everything was going to, was the East Coast to supply Europe, not only through Galveston, that there were shortages of railroad cars that could not bring enough food to the East Coast, and so there were people starving on the East Coast because they couldn't get enough food to them. And we're going to talk a little bit about the Fort Worth airfields. Of course, that's the Royal Flying Corps, and that's what started it here. And here's the three fields. We've got Tolliver One, which became Hicks. Actually, it stayed Tolliver, but we know it as Hicks because of Hicks Station, which was up in here in this area on the bend on the railroad. Barron Field or Tolliver 2, which is for today, Barron Field is down off Everman Parkway. So for today, it's the only or the most intact World War I airfield anywhere in the United States. But that doesn't look like that's going to last much longer. And then Tolliver 3, which was in Carruthers. Barron Field was kind of a basic training field and learning how to fly formation. And at Tolliver 3, Carruthers, that was primarily a photo reconnaissance and a reconnaissance training. And up at Hicks, they did a lot of bombing and air-to-air gunnery. There's a lot of great stories about that. Oh, and out of this, there's one little building right here. You can see right where the light is. Little bitty building about the size of this area. That's the only thing that really remains of Hicks. It's the ammunition building, very similar to what's over at Barron Field. Barron Field, you may know, has got a little ammunition building, but it has windows in it. Those windows were cut into the building in the 20s because it was what was referred to at that point in time as the colored school. So that was the only schoolhouse for them. But that's all that remains. Now, we've been out there and we found that the foundations for most of these hangars are still there. In fact, the buildings that are out there now are built on the foundations from the First World War. So this is the ops area. If we look at this, this is Fort Worth in the center, and these are from old maps. So here's field number 2, that's Barron Field. Field number 3, that's Carruthers. And keep an eye on this little triangular piece right here. Okay? And then this is Hicks, or what we know of as Hicks up there. These are the Benbrook trenches. If you'll notice, and notice the creek bed or the river right here, that's right here. So this trench system was up in here. There was nearly 10 miles of trenches here. Some of it extended even in towards Vickery and in towards the city, and there is some of this stuff that still exists, and we're trying to see if we can get the city to help conserve some of this, because there's very little of it left. These were the U.S. wings at the time. These were special wings, the ones that had the gold U.S. on them. There was a group of pilots that had gone up to Canada to start to train with the Royal Flying Corps, and they were referred to as the 300. They were the first 300 U.S. pilots. 26 of them were naval aviators, and their wings were like this with the gold U.S. The rest of them were all silver. So this is part of, I know many of us are familiar with this map. This was kind of the operating area flying map. It actually goes way up past Gainesville and further down and out here, but this is the operating area that the guys flew in most of the time. For instance, up here in Grapevine, the pilots would do these cross countries, and they would go out to these little communities, and they would land in fields. They'd land in cotton fields and things like that and meet with the locals. In some cases, they'd take them home to dinner, and then they'd come back, or they'd land because they had problems, and while they were being rescued, they'd go into the farmhouses and things and be taken care of. A lot of these communities also, during the Christmas of 1917, since the Canadians weren't going to go home, and neither were a lot of others, they brought these pilots and the mechanics and people who were training here, they brought them into their homes. So we see a lot of Christmas cards that are being sent back to the family talking about Texas and Christmas in Texas. We also just received a plaque at the museum that's about this size, looks like a shield, and it was a soccer plaque that was given to the community by the Royal Flying Corps because they established some soccer teams and soccer leagues here in the area. And so we can see about 3 or 4 years worth of league play on the plaque. So local World War I aircraft. So we talked about the Jenny, and these are the JN4 Canucks. You can see on some of these, there's another strut on the backside. As opposed to this one, you don't see a strut. But here's a strut right here, and that connected the aileron. So the airplane had a lot more capabilities and maneuverabilities. You'll notice the tail is much larger, too, than the regular JN4. So these were referred to as Canucks. Here in North Texas, they were all this tan-brown color. The rest of the state around here and the rest of the United States, they were basic green airplanes. We also had an awful lot of the Thomas More Scouts, the S4s. They were referred to as Tommies because of the Thomas. It was considered an advanced trainer, and it was designed by the same person, Benjamin Thomas, who invented the Jenny. So a lot of these were used, I don't know about a lot, but these were used a lot at Barron Field. We know that for certain. We're not certain what airplanes were at some of the other fields. We also know that the DH-4s, the Dayton Wright was used to some extent later on, like 1918, 1919. These were the Dayton Wrights because these were built here in the U.S. It was a British airplane, but we were starting to manufacture them here. Very sturdy airplane. It was used as a bomber, day bomber. It'd carry about 500 pounds worth of bombs, flew at about 140 miles an hour, would get up to about 22,000 feet. It was a very successful airplane from a lot of standpoints, and it was used after the war commercially for some of the first airmail routes and those types of things. This is one of my favorites. Anybody ever heard of the Breeze Penguin? I know a few of you had. Nobody else? Okay. This is an airplane that's designed not to fly. It has very short, stubby wings. It's a ground trainer. And so the idea was that they would have cages on them so you could roll them over. You're not going to ding the prop. You're not going to do anything. But this is to give pilots an opportunity to maneuver on the ground and try to maneuver the airplane around before they take it off. I was reading a little article about one of the airfields, and I don't know which one it was because these things were pretty much all over the place. But one of these people was writing and observing about how he was watching all of these things around on the field. So there was apparently a lot of them. And he said they're just kind of all darting all over the field in all kinds of different directions. And they'd crash into each other, roll over and stuff. Reminded me of how little kids play a little bit. So that's the Breeze Penguin. And there's one of them that I know of that's up at the Cradle of Aviation Museum in Rhode Island. And then we had SPADs here too, at least at Hicks. We had the SPAD 8. And this picture is from Hicks, by the way. So that makes sense in that that one was up at Hicks. That was aerial gunnery and bombing. The DH-4 was at Barron Field mostly. The Jennies were primarily at Carruthers. This airplane I find interesting because it's a smaller airplane. It's almost half the size of the DH-4. It's not even as fast as the DH-4, and it doesn't have the same service ceiling as the DH-4. And the Jenny, by the way, could only get to about 6,500 feet. These things cost the government about $4,000. These were somewhere in the range of $5,000 to $6,000. So now we're going to go back to the Warriors here a little bit and give you an idea on the livestock. So here's 1917. The total was, remember we were at in 1909, we were just over 2 million animals. By 1917, we were at 3.5. And 1918, we started to fall off, and then it's continued to fall off. So the oil boom and what it did for us. In 1914, the production of oil here brought in $11 million. That's in 1914 dollars. And if you remember, we go back, and when we built the base, when we built everything here, it was about $11 million, and that was about $65 million. Over the years, within 4 years, 3 to 4 years, it more than doubled. So we look at the total World War I Fort Worth impact in 1917 dollars as being close to $50 billion. There isn't anything else that's ever taken place here in North Texas or much of anywhere else that over a shorter period of time had such a large impact on the community. So we go back 1910, here are our numbers. So by 1930, Fort Worth has grown from 73,000 to 102,000, started to fall back off after the war. But for a while, we were bigger than Dallas. Dallas was number two in 1910. It didn't really change position. San Antonio went from number one down to number three. And Houston went from three up to one. So here's some of the aftermath of the war. Urbanization, voting rights changed, prohibition changed, prejudice pretty much stayed the same, but the economics of the country were different. Texas had been introduced to the world, and the world had been introduced to Texas, and neither would be the same since. But then this started to happen in the early 20s. It didn't start here, but it came here. And it created a lot of turmoil. Again, it was a period of turmoil across the country. Now, from 1916 to 1930, is referred to as the Great Migration, with all of the African Americans out of Texas and all the southern states that were actively migrating north. Papers from Chicago and Detroit and Cleveland and Pittsburgh and even on the West Coast were encouraging the African Americans, come here, we're more liberal, you have more opportunities, you'll have a better life here. So there was this great migration of African Americans that left the South and started to head north. But there's a reverse migration that Bill Morris has discovered here locally. He's been doing some study on veterans here in the area. And we started to look at veterans, and so far we've found 7,000 World War I veterans here in Tarrant County. Many of them, nearly half, are not from here. They were from Illinois, Wisconsin, Nebraska, Iowa, Pennsylvania, and Canada. And we didn't quite figure out what that was at first until we started to think about it. And why were they here? The Canadians went back home after the war and said, I've had enough of these winters, and decided to leave. And the same happened across the northern United States. All of those people had trained here. Those units, either through the National Guard or when they became federalized, came here. They trained in Houston, they trained in San Antonio, they trained here in Fort Worth, they served along the border, and they were introduced to the Southwest and they liked it here, and they decided to come back after the war. So we go back today. So this was the oil industry back about the time of the First World War, and that's what it looks like today. Huge increases from 1904 to today. There's the Houston Ship Channel in 1904. There's the Houston Ship Channel today, one of the largest seaports in the entire world. Well, here's cotton. We still do a lot of that, and it's turned into the agriculture movement across the state. And here's this one. We go back to the cart with the ox in the little car back there, and that's turned into that. I'm not sure that's an improvement, but that's what we have. And that all goes back to the standardization of wheelbases and all the rest of that. And of course, ranching, we're still ranchers, and now aviation. Remember, that was the entire United States Air Force in 1911. And then we have the economic engine here locally known as DFW, which produces an economic impact to the community here of roughly $45 billion a year. One out of every five people who live here in the Metroplex work in some aviation-related field. 140,000 people work at DFW. So aviation has gone from that one little airplane that was made out of wood and cloth, and over the years it's developed. After the war, a bunch of those Jennies were sitting over at Barron Field and some of those other airplanes. These pilots came back from after the war and they didn't want to go back to the farms and ranches. So they bought up those airplanes and did whatever they could to keep flying. Who's seen the Great Waldo Pepper? That story, although they talk about Waldo Pepper, is really about Ormer Locklear, who was a local boy here, who started out at flying at Barron Field. Actually, he went down south, but he was an instructor at Barron Field and became known as the original Barnstormer. You know, he knew how to fly, and a couple other people knew how to fly, and their CEO said, well, why don't you go out and fly the airplanes a little bit and see what you can do with them? So they went out and found out that you could walk on the wings, you could transfer between airplanes, you could change wheels in flight, you could do air-to-air refueling, you could do all kinds of different things. And so Ormer and some of his buddies became known as Ormer Locklear and the Lunatics. And they became the original Barnstormers. So they were buying up these airplanes that cost the government $4,000. They were buying them for $100, $200 and kept flying, doing anything they could. They would go in from town to town. They would fly over a town and they'd throw leaflets out to let them know that they were going to be in the area that afternoon giving rides. You know what those leaflets became known as? Who knows? Flyers. They're throwing the leaflets out and people go, oh, look, flyers. So that's how those became known. So they went from there to people would say, can you take this package over to the next town over? Can you take this mail over to here? So they started to conglomerate into little businesses that started to operate out of different areas, two or three or four pilots. Then we got the airmail became viable when they established the airmail routes across the east to west. The airmail routes started going north and south and spreading out. They were the contract airmail routes. All of them going through the southwest came here through Fort Worth. The trains and the mail came through here. Amon Carter saw to it that Fort Worth was established as the center for airmail in the United States, in the southwest United States. So these pilots got together and started to form little flying groups. There was one of them that was called Texas Air Transport, formed down in Austin. And they were flying around doing anything they could, fly a passenger, fly a box, fly this, fly that. One of them decided that he was tired of the flying and he knew that people who were flying needed to have a place where they could get their airplane serviced. So he became known as a fixed base operator, and that's where FBOs came from. So these pilots started doing that. A gentleman named C.R. Smith, who was an accountant for a group that was trying to conglomerate some airlines, went down and made an offer to Texas Air Transport. They became part of a conglomeration which became Southern Air Transport and became one of 12 airlines that became American Airways. And so that's how commercial aviation built up. It was all a direct result of the First World War. And then we've gotten to this out of all of that. So how has aviation changed the area? If you've been to the museum, you've seen our example here. This only goes through 2012 now, so we probably need to do another one of these, right? No. Anybody who helped do these, we will never do another one again. How many airsoft BBs do you think are in this? Some of you people probably know this answer. Pardon? Oh, that's what? Come on, Terry. Terry's one of our docents. He knows. There are just over 68,000 in here. Each one of these represents an airplane that's been built here in North Texas, starting in 1941. The colors are represented by different airplanes. It's now over 70,000 with the F-35s. So you can see this is all World War II. Right here in 1942, we built 8,000 airplanes that year. 8,000 airplanes that year. That's almost 22 airplanes a day. So when you look at 68, 70,000 airplanes and the economic impact of just those airplanes, not the houses, not the grocery stores, the roads, the gas stations, all the rest of that, the economic impact of just that is $1 trillion in today's dollars. White settlement is here because of that took place down here. 30,000 people, they needed 30,000 people to work. They built white settlement. I mean, white settlement had been there, but they started to build the housing in white settlement. It became known as Liberator Village. So at any rate, to get our heads around what that really means is 70,000 airplanes, if we go back to the day of first flight, which is January 12, 1911 here, that's two airplanes a day, every day for 106 years. And $1 trillion is $22 million a day, every day, for 106 years. So that gives you some idea of the magnitude of those numbers. Now, that's just the aircraft that were built here. So we've got 68,000 aircraft and counting, $1 trillion just to get it started. Today, over 600,000 jobs, or one in five here in North Texas, are aviation-related jobs. The total economic output is over $40 billion a year, and that's from DFW. DFW serves 63 million people and handles 648,000 tons. That's 1.5 million pounds a year, and it's getting bigger. But nearly 50% of the people who live here now didn't live here 25 years ago, so they have no sense of the community that aviation produced here. And so when people talk about, is history relevant? History is relevant. It provides us a sense of community. And the more we know about our history, the tighter our community becomes. In addition to all kinds of other examples for leadership and things that people can learn from. So, World War I resources. If you are interested in learning more, and there's going to be a whole lot of stuff and there's a whole lot of resources out there right now. This is the National Commission, and it's just World War number one, centennial.org. The Texas History, or the Texas Military Forces Museum has the war cards or the military cards on all of those 200,000 Texas soldiers, every one of them. We are one of the only states in the country that still has its cards. They were all supposed to be turned in a bunch of years ago. And most everybody dutifully turned them in. Texas was late. And at any rate, everybody's cards got burned up in St. Louis in a fire. Texas has the original cards. They have them there. The cards have been scanned. You can go into their website. You can look and find if you've got relatives. Or if you do know you have relatives, you can see their service card. Texas Time Travels. This is real interesting. It's an app from the Texas Historic Commission. It's probably going to go live here before long. The app is live right now, but we've been working with them for a couple years now on putting together a travel app for Texas for the First World War. When we first started this, we kind of jokingly said to each other, I wonder if we can find enough things to be able to do this app in Texas. Well, I can tell you that we left a lot of stuff on the floor. We found so much. The First World War is just under the surface everywhere here. Texas Historic Commission. There's stuff there. They're getting ready to put out a website. The Texas State Library, plenty of stuff there. This is the logo for us here locally. This is the Texas World War I Centennial Commemoration Association. It's Texas World War Number One Centennial.org. And that will tell you what's going on here in the state. No Man's Land is a study that's been done by a woman who's a friend of ours on the East Texas World War I African-Americans. She's identified at least 11,000 of them. And Texas State Historical Commission, this is their 120th anniversary. This is a great site if you've got kids or you're dealing with education. It's Neo K-12, and they've got a whole plethora of stuff on World War I that you can use in classrooms. This is the website for the Texas World War I Centennial Commemoration. Lots of things, forums, events, places, just a good place to go. And again, it's Texas World War Number One Centennial.org. So here's the things that we're asking everybody to do. This is the three things that you can do to help commemorate the First World War. Number one is the poppy. Plant them, learn about them, teach them, and wear them. It's a great conversation starter, and it's a simple thing to do. Fort Worth Garden Club is going to attempt to do some mass plantings along Camp Bowie. We've been working with some of the communities around here to do that in different places. They're a weed, so it's really pretty simple to get them to grow. But we're almost past the stage of being able to plant them this year. And people, veterans, find them, remember them, and honor them. They've all got great stories, but just walking through the cemetery, we're finding is that probably at least 40% of the veterans do not have a military marker on their grave because it's part of a family marker, a part of a family plot. So it'll be the husband and wife and things like that. So there are ways to do that. You can look them up through those cards. You can look up death records. We are putting together some material. And our goal is for 1911, for Veterans Day in 1911, is to mark all of the graves in Tarrant County of all the World War I veterans. And so we're working with some groups to do that. But there's plenty of ways that you can help with some of that too. And then the other one is monuments. There are virtually monuments in every town and city in Texas. Find the monuments, see if they need cleaning up and refurbishing, and do something to commemorate the First World War. It can be as simple as some of the things we've heard of, that people are gonna play taps every night at the monument for 2 years. That's all they're gonna do. Go out and play taps at the monument, and that's it. Others, for here for April 8th, we're gonna do a little bit more. We're not exactly sure what that's gonna be yet, but we're gonna do a little bit more than just playing taps. But there are plenty of opportunities to do some types of commemoration. Hollis has been involved over at one of the synagogues here, and they've done some great things over there. Here in North Texas, we have been working for well over a year now, and we will start an exhibit over at the Fort Worth Central Library beginning in July. July 9th, I think, will be the opening day, and it'll go through October 28th, and then we're going to do another one in 1918. But it's going to be how the war affected people here in North Texas, and especially Fort Worth. So this is a little bit, these are some rack cards that we used to have. They're kind of getting like hen's teeth. We don't have many around. But you can start with the National Commission. You can find out what's going on here in the state. We have, there are a couple of Facebooks. There's one here for North Texas. There's another one for Camp Bowie. We've got the North Texas website should be up here in another week or so. And so I'd like to thank you. Remember the poppies. And are there any questions? Yeah, Wes.
If you go over to the UTA library, they got a heck of an archive of Fort Worth from those years.
The special collection, what Wes is talking about, special collection at UT Arlington has a great collection of World War I stuff. TCU has all of the Star Telegrams from that period of time, and it's great stuff to look through. Yeah, Don. Oh, yeah, the show and tell stuff. Well, this is a pendant from the Mexican Border Service, 1916, and the flag, that's about 22 by 36 inches. This is a flag that was given to us recently that somebody found in California, and it made its way to us. The actual flag is about the size of the blue field. And this is a flag that was autographed, as they call it, old pals of Tolliver, Texas, from the Canadian 81st Canadian Training Squadron. So these guys all took this little flag and they all autographed it with their names and where they were from and things like that. So I encourage you to come down and look at that afterwards. It's really a very special piece. Anything else? Yes, ma'am.
Working. There it is. Sorry. The large map of the emigration?
Yeah.
The migration.
This one.
What is that term, exodusters?
The what?
The central box.
Oh, right here?
Right there. Am I reading that as exodusters?
Yeah, exodusters eventually left Kansas and Oklahoma for California. I don't know. I guess it's the people who were part of the exodus may have settled in Kansas, Oklahoma, and California for a while, or that's just where they were. The Dust Bowl, of course. Yeah. Does that help? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have Canadian friends who wear a poppy on their World War II
right
memorial. They call it Memorial Day or something like that?
Remembrance Day.
Yeah. Is such a thing going to be available for this?
Well,
like that you could wear?
We happen to have poppy pins at the museum in the gift shop. So you're welcome to come by and look for them there. You're going to find them in a lot of places from now on. American Legion is going to start, and VFW is going to start having available more often than when they're soliciting. But it's been considered the remembrance flower in Great Britain and Canada for a long time. It has transcended from being just the remembrance flower for people who died in the First World War to now it's considered the remembrance flower for any member of the military who died in any of the wars. Ted.
Jim, do they still have that every other year commemoration at Greenwood on the Canadian-British?
Yes. Yeah, in fact,
will you get that on the website when
it's
coming
up? Yeah,
it'll
be on the website, and Doc Murphy is the one who leads the charge on that. As it turns out, this is one of the years. They do it every 2 years. So this year on Memorial Day at Greenwood Cemetery, there will be a remembrance ceremony there. Because if you're not aware, there are 12 graves of Royal Flying Corps personnel who are buried here, and it's part of the Commonwealth's grave system. There's that area of land that actually belongs to the Commonwealth. And so representatives from there usually come out for the service. Bill Morris has found at least three other Royal Flying Corps members who are not buried over there, one in Greenwood and two or three others in other cemeteries around here. Hollis.
Are there any historic markers at the three airfields?
At the three airfields. The only markers at the airfields are at Barron Field. Barron Field has one state historic marker, and there's actually two or three others there. There's one dedicated to Ormer Locklear. There's another one that is thanking the Garden Club for erecting the monuments there. Otherwise, there are no monuments erected at any of the other fields. The Carruthers Field, the one in Benbrook, is virtually all gone, except a lot of houses were built on foundations of the hangars and things like that, but there are no markers there. There are no markers up at Hicks. Yes, sir.
Would you speak to the Wobblies or the IWW and how they affected the war effort? And they were accused in some of the western states where they grew wheat that the Germans funded the IWW in opposition. And
I'm not familiar with the IWW.
To disrupt the growing of wheat to the war effort.
Well, the Germans were trying to do that all over the country. Mentioned that one of the largest groups of ethnic groups here in the United States were German Americans. There's a lot of activity going on the East Coast where people were putting bombs and things on the ships that were being shipped out. The Germans were doing that and sabotaging ships that were going out from the East Coast, and they were active all over the country.
Yeah, I think they were called the Wobblers.
They may be. I'm not familiar with that term, but yeah, rules. Anybody else? Anything? Yes, sir.
So I was wondering, it's probably been 10, 15 years since I've actually flown into Meacham. There used to be out by Hicks to the east a concrete representation of an aircraft laid in the ground, and I was actually wondering if that's still out there.
Yes, it is. It's deteriorating badly. It's on the Bonds Ranch area. It's off of Bond Ranch Road. It's no longer accessible. The only reason it's even partly there is that there was a fence that was put around it. And it wasn't put around it to protect it. It was to keep the cattle from falling in and breaking their legs. But what he's talking about is that whole area west of, was it 287 up there, goes all the way over to the lake, was all of the gunnery ranges and bombing ranges. They used to bomb Eagle Mountain Lake and all over the area up there. They had targets which were the representation of an airplane that were dug out in the ground, and then they were concreted in, and they were filled with water. So when they shot, they had observation towers around them. So when the pilots would shoot at the targets, if they hit the target, they'd get splashes of water, and that's how they could tell how their hits were going. So yes, it's out there, but it's deteriorating badly. One more trivia item. Why do we have fences around airports? Does anybody know this one? To keep the cows out, but why?
They eat the fabric.
They love the fabric. They like the dope on the fabric. And so the cows would get up next to the airplanes and they'd start licking the dope off of the wings and ruin the rings. So that's how we started putting fences up around airfields back to the First World War. There's something every day that we deal with goes back to that. Anything else? Because I know we're running late here. Yes, sir.
Camp Bowie on the side of
houses. Yeah, houses. The only thing that remains somewhat of Camp Bowie that you can go and visit, but you can't see anything there, is Veterans Memorial Park. That's about where the headquarters building used to be. We're going to have a lot of things in the display at the Central Library that will show you Camp Bowie then and now. But most of it is gone. There are still a smattering of buildings around the Arlington Heights area that are over 100 years old and were there during the camp. But there is nothing left of the camp, and there are virtually no markers over there to tell you where anything is. Okay, I'm going to put in one less shameless plug for the museum. April 29th, we're going to do our annual Hops and Props Festival. So we've got rack cards if any of you would like these. It's a craft beer festival and fly-in. We've got about 10 or 12 airplanes coming in besides our own. We just finished up this last weekend refurbishing an F-105 Thunder Chief. And that, along with the 111 we completed a couple of months ago, we're going to dedicate those on that day. We're also going to be putting together a military encampment, including we've got a group coming up from Houston that's bringing an APC and a gun truck, and they're going to be able to give you rides in a track vehicle. We're doing beer flights like we did last year and all the rest of it. So if you're at all interested, I'm going to leave the rack cards up here for you. And if there's nothing else, I'm going to give it back to Bob.